That was quite the intro.
Thank you, Wally.
Okay, am I on?
Yes, I am. Debbie, we're checking on you. My lab number? She's gone.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody here this morning on this beautiful morning. It's very comfortable for me. It's not too hot yet. It's just gorgeous. It's good to see extra people here today. The side of my right keeps me looking at people who are much taller. And it was very easy to
How
see.
Are you?
Okay, am I on? What's happening here? Good morning. Together, let us read our sentences. Come and hear, all you fear God. Listen to one another as you tell what God has done.
God has listened to our prayers in steadfast love. God has tested us, but has not rejected us.
Have no fear, and do not be thought of trouble. The Spirit of truth dwells in you.
God is never far from us, even though unknown. The Spirit gives us breath and keeps us alive.
Bless God, all nations. Let praise be heard. God has brought us to this turn and to this place.
In Christ we live and move and have our beginning. We are made righteous and restored in wholeness.
In our first reading this morning is a very, very appropriate word. Hymn number 560, For the Beauty of the Earth. Rather avoid looking at hurts that we have inflicted on others. But Christ invites us to full confession that we might be free from new life. Together, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Compassionate
God, grant us please that we are inclined to worship will inspire us to leave this place peacemakers and joy givers. For the times that we have gazed are so fixed upon you that we fail to see the need of all around us, forgive us.
For having our hands in trials, when Jesus was there to try us,
forgive us. For being insensitive and abrupt with a friend or stranger when they come to help us, forgive us.
Lord, help us to teach our children to charge.
Will we both help us to treat them as you would? Amen.
Having confessed our sins, we know that God does not hold our sins against us or put us to shame. We've already received his mercy, which is we earnestly and honestly seek. God is faithful and equips us to grow into salvation. Our Creator sees our affliction and he delivers us. We are God's people, and God is our rock and our fortress, because in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. And knowing that we are forgiven, we ask how we shall then live. And we usually hear all kinds of, we can do the whole Ten Commandments, we can do the single commandment, we can do all kinds of things. But this morning, I'm going to give you just one thing that we are supposed to do, and that's love. We can take all the commandments and everything else and reduce them all down to just that one word. Love God, love one another. Love the white lives who've been given, love the world that we live in, and love all those around us. See what happens when I start talking after the air.
Sacrifice that animal to you and offer you grain. I will offer bulls and goats.
Coming here, all you who fear God, let me tell you what he has done for me.
I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise was on my tongue.
If I have cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened.
But God has surely listened and has heard my prayers.
Praise be to God, who has not rejected my prayer or withheld his love for me.
Amen.
Thank you.
5:33, Oklahoma Club.
Do not be frightened, but in your heart revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you love, that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who seek maliciously against your good behavior, against your good behavior in Christ, may be ashamed of their slander. For all is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built. It is only a few people, 8 in all, who were saved through water. And this water is a symbol of baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from your body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers, in submission to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the words of your mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our leader. It's Mother's Day. It's a day when we honor mothers. It's a day when we think of those who have given so much to us, whether they are actual physical mothers, or mothers in the church, or people who have mothered us in many ways throughout our lives. I'm trying to figure out where to start with first. As I was working on this last past week, I came across a passage from Billy Graham, and I'm going to use it right now so that it can convict each and every one of us, because I'm sure we could all use a little of that conviction. And he says, "It is far easier to live an excellent life among our friends, where we can be putting our best foot forward, conscious of public opinion. It is far more difficult to live for Christ in our own home, with our own family circle, where they know whether Christ lives with us in us or not." He continues, "I am a Christian, a true Christian. I will not give way at home to bad temper, impatience, fault-finding, sarcasm, unkindness, suspicion, selfishness, or laziness. Instead, I will reveal through my daily life the fruits of the Spirit, which are love, joy, peace, long-suffering, and all the other Christian virtues, which are part of the Christian personality." How are you? It truly is much easier to do it when you are out in public than it is at home. I mean, you can sit at home and, you know, what happens behind these walls, nobody knows except us, but yeah, they do. So, why that was here to kind of convict everybody, convict each of us of who we really are. He continues on with one more paragraph, and it says, "Every mother owes to her children to accept Christ as her personal Savior, so that she may be the influence for good in their lives, those whom Christ has entrusted and given to her." Okay, moms, I don't know what that does for you, but boy, that's a huge responsibility. I titled my sermon this morning, "Why Does It Hurt?" And the passage from Peter, and all of Peter, here have basically been, you know, we're going to do what we think is right. If we do that, God will be with us. But that doesn't mean that we're not going to be hurt. That doesn't mean that there's not a lot of hurt down in our lives. You were thinking of persecution in a much bigger sense than what I have tried to focus on this morning. I want to keep this a little bit lighter because it is Mother's Day. Why does it hurt? I don't know how often I've heard that when my children were growing up. Why does it hurt? I befriended a friend on the playground, but it wasn't the friend that everybody thought I should befriend. Why does it hurt? I helped this kid with his homework, and it came back to bite me because he took credit for all the work that I had done. Why does it hurt? I helped this challenged kid on the playground today, and I know it was the right thing to do, but he was so concerned and so upset with what was going on. He didn't really get me. Why does it hurt? When you're doing what's right? Why does it hurt when you're the parent, when you're the child? When the whole world is in front of you and is watching what you're doing. So I decided that I would share several stories of why does it hurt in my life. I remember being at church one Sunday morning. Now, we were in church, we took up lots of space, but this was a Sunday morning when it was just me and several of the older girls. I say older, not really terribly older. I think the oldest one was about 6. And at collection time, the usher came with a basket and went past us. Now, we always sat up front. That was basically so that people, they couldn't see people doing things wrong behind them. But what it also did is set us up for a lot of observation because everybody behind us could see us. So the collection is going up and your usher is 3/4 of the way down the aisle. And my daughter's standing there saying, come on, come back here, I have a gift. And everybody behind us is also saying, come on back. And you do. And she very nicely opened her purse and took out a penny. There was laughter behind us. Lots of laughter. I was one very embarrassed one. When we got out to the car, I looked at her and I said, why did you do that? Why couldn't you just wait? Why did you have to do that then? And she looked at me and said, but Mom, the widow's penny was important, isn't mine? Hello, Mom. Are you going to make it through here? You know? It was one of those embarrassing moments, to say the least. And you know, I wasn't always the perfect mom, and I certainly didn't have the perfect kids, so I only will attest to that for you. And there was one who had a habit of doing the same thing over and over and over and never seeming to learn. And one day, I just looked at her and I said, okay, and she wouldn't look at me. And I took and put one finger on either side of her mouth, and I said, would you please look at me and listen to me? I can't remember what the offense was, but what I do remember is at that point, she starts spitting, and out comes a bloody tooth. That tooth was ready to come out for a long time. It took that minute just to come out like that and there. Felt like the worst mom that ever came down the pipe. But what I did do was set an example for others. They weren't going to take any chances without becoming mom again. You know, when I was going back to seminary, it became very, very difficult sometimes to try and make things work the way they were supposed to work, and be the mom and be away at the same time. There was one Sunday when I was home, And Saturday night late, or maybe it was early morning, I got a phone call, a message from downstairs, and I don't feel good. And then a while later, I got a second message. Mom, I really don't feel good. I was scheduled to preach two services that morning at a church that I'd never preached at before, and I didn't have any contact information for anybody. So we made him a call to urgent care, and we put him in the car, and we went to urgent care. The result was, this is an appendicitis. He needs to get to the hospital immediately. Where is my devotion? Who do I honor first? Do I honor my son? Do I honor my commitment to God? It's 8:30, I'm supposed to be preaching at 8. It's 8 o'clock, I'm supposed to be preaching at 8:30. They dropped me off at church and they went to the hospital. I made it through two services. I got lots of prayers. And I also got a ride to the hospital as soon as I was finished with the first second service. Tim had just come out of surgery. He was on his way back to his room. I didn't do the mantras, but I had other people there who were helping, who were supporting. He had the medical staff, and I had the people of that church behind me 100%. What do you think about that? There was another time that I had been away. I've been away for 2 weeks. And it was about the same time that the fair was taking place. And they had all gone to the fair, and they had taken the horse and the camper, and they were camping out at the fair. Well, the fairground doesn't have just the animal tents. It also has a vendors and all kinds of people there. So Mom arrived, and I was feeling very guilty for being away for a week and a half and not being there for the kids. My daughter came up to me and she said, Mom, this man, I'm losing the terminology, this man on the freeway here, on the pathway, he is selling cockroaches, and he has hissing cockroaches. Can I buy one? We had a habit, whenever we bought an animal, you had to research it first. You had to know all about it and know what you were getting into. Well, there was just enough mom guilt that day, but mom didn't bother to do that. Mom just let it go. And she said, yes, you can buy it, but you can only buy one. She did. We put it in the mayonnaise jar with a very tight top on it. And about a week later, I looked at it, and we didn't have one. We had probably 201. I didn't honor that pet for very long. It was out of the house just as fast as I could move to the door. Mother guilt. What does it do for you? And you know, I'm telling these stories, but I'm sure there isn't a mother out there who couldn't probably top some of these 100%. I'm trying to. That's funny. I'm going to end with just two. We were on vacation, and we were over at the cave. My favorite spot. That's what I'm going back. We went to an estate sale, and my daughter bought this lovely little—I always call it a hippie bag. Just a nice little bag. It was definitely within the price range. Was great. She got it back out on the farm, and she looked in the cardboard bag, and inside the bag were 5 grams of marijuana. Well, we made a really big deal out of it, and they were afraid all the way back to the cottage because they were sure the police were going to come and get them and the whole nine yards and, you know, we really used it as an educational tool. Got back to the cottage, and we flushed them. And I figured that was the end. It was all fine and good until we went back to school. Tessa's first comment to her teacher was, "My mom bought me marijuana when we were over at the Cape." Can't make these stories up, you really can't. Raising kids is wonderful, but it's challenging. It never ends. I know you moms who've been moms for a while now. They grow up, and their little problems turn into big problems, and little joys turn into big joys. And the families continue to grow. Heck, we started out with the 14 kids, and we've now added 25 grandkids to them. It goes on and on. Families are wonderful, but they are challenging. And when we look at being persecuted in Peter's sense, he's looking at heavy-duty persecution, but we don't have to look too far because we can find it right within our own families. It could be a little jab here, a little jab there, and just little things that we don't think are important at all that can make a big difference, and that can be there with you forever. I can tell stories forever. I can tell stories of kids getting along with one another, kids getting not along with one another. You know, then and then. Our families are based on love. And as Billy Graham says, it's harder to show that love always at home than it is when you're out with others. Maybe it's because we think that what goes on at home isn't seen. Maybe we think that that's the time we can let down our hair and be ourselves and be real. When we're out with people, sometimes we put on, I wouldn't say we put on airs, but we try to be on our good behavior. I think there's not a mother out there that has not heard the time, street angel, house devil. And if you have kids, it can be either one or the other. You'd much prefer to have them behave when they're out than when they're in. But that's not what God wants from us. God wants us to be show that love constantly. So all you mothers out there, thank you for all you've done. For all of you who aren't mothers, you've all had mothers, and look back at some of those memories, because they're there for all of us, the good and the bad. But you know, I don't think there's a mother out there that hasn't always tried to do the best that she could possibly do. Good, and one more story. When I worked at the food pantry, I saw lots of families. They came in regularly. And it got to the point after many years, I reached a point that I just couldn't take any more. And I was working on the week I was working was going to be my last week for a while, and I was taking a leave of absence. I was in church. It was night. It was dark. The building was dark. I was the only one there. And there came a knock at the door. And I answered it. And in came Sabrina. I worked with Sabrina regularly over the years. She had been so proud of herself because she had put Christmas presents on layaway for her kids. And she had just told me the day before that she'd made the final payment and she was going to go and pick up those toys. But she came to the door. And there were no toys. Her boyfriend had taken the layaway slip, cashed it in. She had nothing. She was left with nothing. And she looked at me and she said, "I know you'll help me. You've always helped me. You're always there when I need your help. You've never let me down." And I'm sitting there thinking, I'm about to leave you. But what I said was, "No, I'm not always there for you, but there will always be acknowledges him good through bad, through everything. And as I'm saying this, all of a sudden, I startled. Because what I was saying was what I needed to hear, and what we all need to hear. Yup, there are going to be those days that are tough. There's going to be persecution, there's going to be things that go wrong, jobs that don't work, bills that don't get paid, all kinds of things that, they're not the persecution that we're looking at, but they are things that we do all face, and we don't necessarily, we don't have to face them alone. So what I'm trying to pass the burden is that I'm not going to be there when somebody will be. But what God is telling me is, yeah, I am always there, and you need to hear that too. We all need to hear that. Life is full of the good, the bad, and in between. Parents are going to see good times and bad times. Kids are going to think parents are great, and they're going to think parents are not so great at all. It all goes on. It's all part of our cycle. But we do know that no matter what happens, God is looking at us, and God loves us more than we can possibly love one another. And the goal to us is love. Love one another. Love those kids. Even when they do the things they're not supposed to. Whether they're 2 or 22 or 42 or 52. We're still parents. We still have responsibilities. We still are looking to be that Christian example to everyone that we meet. So happy Mother's Day. Not terribly uplifting, and I'm kind of giving you all flowers and gifts. But the realization that God is with us is probably the greatest gift that any of us could ever receive. And he's always there for each and every one of us. The way may be difficult, it's not always going to be easy. But there's always hope. The hope of that future home that waits for us. No matter how bad things may seem now, tomorrow will be a better day. And eternity will be the best ever. Amen. Now that the one who by the power within us is able to do far more than all we can ask or imagine, to God be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Oh God, because we have been given so much, help us to give more to others. Because we have loved so much, give us the strength to love more. Let us give as we are able, as we hear, to introduce it to more.
Can anybody hear me? Is this on?
Yep.
It is. I'm going to play Lady of Knock. And I didn't have a clue what Lady of Knock was, but it's a town in Ireland. You probably all know this, but I don't know anything. Anyway, Knock is in Ireland. It's a town in Ireland. And many, many, many years ago, before we were born, Mary, there was a vision of Mary. And so they called the Queen of Ireland. And that's what the music is about. I thought a little history of what's going on. So, and then I also add Wally notes, everybody knows, that aren't written. But anyway, I appreciate that my music's on YouTube, Wally Jones Music. You can hear stuff here from every week for the new people. So Lady of Knock, I'm gonna let her rip.
Thank you.
May they be an indication of our devotion to you, the devotion of our love, our lives, and all the new things. Blessed be God forever. Amen.
Could we change that last hymn to page 554? I'll fly away.
Five five four.
I want to just let it rip and just blow the ceiling off the place. I'll put it back when we're done. Okay, I'll fly away Wally style. I'm not even going to play it in this key. I'm going to pick a key of G and just go for it. Okay.
554.